John Pullman with you again for another edition of Gridiron Media Sports, AYS, on the Gridiron. We're here. We're doing these shows now during this whole, you know, crazy time we're having in the country here with this virus. And we're talking to some legends. And today we've got one of the forgotten legends of not only the Denver Broncos, but a bunch of clubs. Well, look, I had to put my blue and orange sunglasses on because it's going to get bright up in here. With Gene Mingo, number 21, Denver Broncos Ring of Famer. What's going on, Gene?
Not much, man. You know, it's I must say that it's an honor to talk to you.
No, that's back at you. That's back at you because you're the one. You're the man.
Well, you know, I did what I could do back in the 60s. And, you know, I hear that I'm a legend all the time, everywhere I go. And it bothers me a little bit because I was told at one time by, he came to the Broncos late in the 60s, Odell Berry. He said, Gene, he says, what you've done, you know, being a kicker and all that, that is nothing, man. He said, nobody's going to recognize that. And, you know, to this day, it seems like nobody has recognized that I became the first black field goal kicker in the AFL and also in the NFL.
That's pretty amazing, especially for, like you were talking earlier, your career didn't really start in high school necessarily.
Well, no, it didn't. My freshman year of high school, I did win the state championship, against East High School. And, you know, after that, a few years of high school and everything, I had a Southern teacher come up and take over a class. And he was on the blackboard, and I said, a little later, I raised my hand, as you were supposed to do when you were in school, you know, to get attention. And I said, I need help. And he said, well, look at the big football player. He needs help. Well, that sort of got my nerves. And I stood up and I said in front of everybody, the hell with this white man's learning. I'll join the Navy. And that's what I did. Oh. Well, I wasn't old enough to actually join. I had to get my father to sign the papers for me to go into the Navy.
And so this is all started up in Akron, Ohio.
It most certainly did.
And so from the Navy, you parlayed the service not only into, you know, getting a little bit of education, further education, but it's also where you started playing really, really, really real football, so to speak.
That is so true. I ran across so many pro athletes playing in service, which there were back in those days in the 60s, pretty much all the bases had teams. And I played against some of the best, Rosie Greer, Sherman Plunkett, Lee Riley. They had a punt returner. I will tell you a little story. We played Fort Dix, New Jersey. We went in at halftime up 7-0. And it happened to be raining that day. And the next thing I know, at halftime, we go back out on the field. And it's raining like crazy. I kick off. And this dude, he was a running back from the Los Angeles Rams. He took that thing all the way back. The score ended up 57-7 in favor of Fort Dix. Whoa. But anyway,
Who was that guy?
I really don't remember his name, but
he started the snowball.
it started the snowball. Those guys just showed me that you had to prove yourself. And every team that I played on, being that I hadn't gone to college, being that I was playing from high school, playing service ball, playing against some of the best service players that you could play against, I had to do good or else I would be sent back to the base. But I set so many records. I did so many things. As a matter of fact, when I was inducted into the Ohio Hall of Fame, in 1986 when the guy got up on the stage and he said, "Now, our next celebrity, I want you all to listen to what he did." This man read off so many things that I had done in service. I have never, and even to the day, I haven't looked back at what I did, you know, as far as scoring or yardage or whatnot.
Different positions played, number of positions played.
Well, back in that day, for a black man to play pro football, he had to play more positions. I remember when I started to play pro football, I was running, getting in shape at my old high school, South High School. And Willie Davis, who was with the Cleveland Browns, who moved up to the Green Bay Packers, I was there with another defensive end for the Denver Broncos who stopped by Akron to see me. We worked out together, and this guy that I was with, he said, "Yeah," he says, "Mingo is kicking field goals." And Willie Davis said, "Kicking field goals." I was happy. I was, you know, sitting up. I was in my, I was just overjoyed. And Willie Davis said, "I'm going to tell you something." He said, "They don't want you. And as soon as they can, they'll get you away from there. And what you have to do is keep clean." In other words, perform your duties as a football player, play as hard as you can, but keep your nose clean. I tried to do that as much as I could. I love people. I love making people happy. When I stepped on the football field, my wife actually told me, her father told her, that I was a different person. I didn't realize that. You know, I was playing pro football, and that was good. And it meant something back in those days to have PRO at the beginning of your name, and I was playing football.
Now, how did you transition over from the service into pro football?
Well,
all this
actually,
stuff was all happening at the same time. Korean War was ending. The AFL was kind of coming up, and the NFL was already rolling. How did you make that switch, and how easy or difficult was it?
It really wasn't difficult. I've always said, well, my aunt, I was brought up in a very religious family, and one thing my aunt said, "There is a word I never want to hear you say or whatever come out of your mouth," and that was, "I can't." Right. And from that time on, you had to prove to me that you were better than me, that you were stronger than me, or that you could beat me up or whatever. I don't care how big you were, you had to prove it to me. I didn't quit. And that was something that was drilled into me. You asked me about...
When you get ready to jump out of the service, now you've got a little bit of high school, but you've got a lot of military ball in you. And so now comes the time to try to make this move into something that could last for a few years.
Well, actually, I was with the Broncos. I wrote them a letter, and Bertha, who has passed away, my sister, she critiqued the letter, and I still don't spell that well. My wife gets on me about spelling. You know, she says, "You know, I do, but I'm putting down the paper is a little different." Anyway, we were in Golden, and Frank Philchuk was down on the lower field at School of Mines with some punters and field goal kickers. And he was trying to develop some of the players to be their field goal kicker, our field goal kicker. And one of the guys that I played service ball with was up on the other hill with me, and we were goofing around. And so Philchuk blew his whistle, and he said a few choice words. "I'm trying to build a you-know-what football team, and you're up there effing off." Well, this player pushed me out and said, "Mingo can kick." And he said, "You can." I said, well, yeah. He said, well, if you think you can kick, come on down here. And so I went down to the lower field. And the first time I tried to kick a football, I had a round toe shoe on, and I kicked the ball, and it went through the upright. I felt pretty good about that. So Phil Chuck said, can you do it again? Well, like an old time, or I always say like a golfer, when you slice the ball, I kicked the ball and it went off to the right. And Phil Chuck said, oh, get out of here. And I turned and started to walk away, and something said, no, ask him for another chance.
Here you go.
And I did. I said, can I have another chance? He said, oh, no. He said, go on, get out of here. I said, no, give me another chance. He said, okay, move it back 10 yards. And we moved it over on the left hash mark. I kicked the ball through. We moved it over to the right hash mark. I kicked the ball through.
Go ahead.
He said, move it back to the 35. I kicked the ball through. And he said, Posey, he said, get this man a kicking shoe. Let's see what he can do with a real kicking shoe on.
Because back then they used a square toe.
Well, that's right. I have the last pair of kicking shoes I wore. I just want people to realize what I did without college, going to college, being the first black field goal kicker, leading the league in scoring in my inaugural year of the American Football League. In 1961, they brought in so many players to take my position as a field goal kicker. The kickers couldn't do it. Each kick that they put up there, I would out kick him. And so.
And this is why you were playing in the regular game other positions sometimes.
I played seven different positions for the Broncos. I recovered my own onside kicks.
Okay.
I went down and made tackles on kickoffs. Phil Chuck even fined me $50, and I didn't get paid that much in the first place. I would go down the field and make the tackle, and sometimes I would tackle the ball carrier, make him fumble the ball on this one time. I hit this guy so hard. I mean, it was the Buffalo Bills. I hit him so hard, he fumbled the ball, and I got right up and got on top of that ball. But I don't know how many field goal kickers nowadays recover their own onside kick.
It's incredible.
I did so many things. I played offensive tackle, defensive tackle, cornerback. If you want to put somebody in the Hall of Fame, which I've heard that I'll never get in, but I keep hearing, yeah, you'll get in. And what, you know, nobody remember what Gene Mingo did in the 60s, the early years.
Well, and back in those days, I mean, like you mentioned before, you know, this wasn't, we're talking about a society that was not integrated very much at all. I mean, these are the days when, you know, I played in the mid-60s. When we went to East St. Louis for the Granite City Tournament or something like that, a wrestling tournament, they wouldn't let the black players stay in East St. Louis. We had to go somewhere else. East St. Louis was mostly all black. I was like, well, wait a minute. And so we had to go to another hotel, and half the team would stay somewhere, and half, you know, that. I mean, these were bad days in American history.
Well, I know that they were, because we went to play the Dallas Texans, who are now the Kansas City Chiefs. Mm-hmm. We went to play the Dallas Texans in Fort Little Rock, Arkansas. And they had taken this large mansion and made it into a black hotel, or that's what they claim it was. They put a
breakfast.
We had two rooms. They put cots in the rooms for the six black players that was on the team at that time that we could stay. Henry Bell, myself, and I can't remember the other player that we had in the room, but I do remember it was raining, but Henry looked on the wall, and my God, there come a big tarantula down that wall. And you can laugh if you want to, but Henry Bell was his name. He was a fullback. He threw his shoe. We used to call him No Neck Bell because he didn't have a neck. he was a powerful little runner. But anyway, we went out to play this game against the Kansas City, the Dallas Cowboys. And most of the black players, we got in the middle of the team to go out on the field. And up in the stands, these men were coming to the game. They had their bib overalls on. You know what those are. They had those suspenders and stuff on them. And all that. And they said, "All right, you boys, you better not hit none of them white boys out there. If you do, we're going to kill you." And they had shotguns in the stands, man.
A little added pressure.
it was a lot of pressure, like you said. Back in the 60s, it was hard to make a team. You had to prove yourself. You go back and look at it. Jim Brown, of the Cleveland Browns, was the biggest thing that we as black people had to look up to. I used to watch games and stuff of Jim Brown playing in it.
Couldn't tackle him.
You couldn't tackle him, and he used to run over a lot of the white players. But getting back to me, I can't understand being the first black field goal kicker, doing what I did, that the Broncos don't take advantage of that.
Let me ask you. You played for the Broncos, but you didn't start with the Broncos, did you?
Yes, I did.
Okay,
I
started with the Broncos, but you had five other teams. Is that right?
I went from the Broncos. I went to the Oakland Raiders a year and a half. The Miami Dolphins. Joe Robbie was the manager. Very prejudiced man. I was there a year and a half. Went to the Washington Redskins. Otto Graham, which I think you might have heard the story when Jim Brown was blocking, he missed the block and Otto got tackled and Otto jumped all over him. Well, Paul Brown was the coach at that time and he said, "I'm not paying Jim Brown to the block for you. I'm paying him to run and I'm paying you to throw the ball. You don't get on Jim no more. If you have any problems with Jim, you come to me." And I don't know.
And these were days when, when you would come to a city, you would see the signs, colored water fountain, colored bathroom, all that stuff.
You would see it, but, that we blacks, we stayed together. Chuck Gavin, who's passed away, was a defensive end with us. He had played with the Chicago Bears or tried out with the Chicago Bears, and Lionel Taylor was another one. They sort of watched out for me.
This is the book that's written about you. This is called Gene Mingo, the Forgotten Legend. And so this book chronicles all that you have done in pro sports. Showed you coming up and how you took care of your mother, and that's part of the reason why you missed your high school career. But as you look back and you look at where we are today with football, with young people, so many young people taking advantage of the game and trying to emulate folks like yourself, what do you tell a young person? Our show is kind of geared. We try to gear our show to the young, the youngsters who are just coming up in middle school, and so we try to let them hear from people like yourself and talk about what is important for them to make it going into high school and subsequently perhaps even going into college to play football.
Well, if I had gone to college, I keep telling everybody I'm from Ohio, and being from Ohio, I'm a Buckeye fan all the way. that's one thing I would love to do before I pass away is walk on that walk on the Ohio State football field. But the players of today, that I say they make too much money. That, you know, to each his own. You say what you want to, but the money that these players are getting and the things that they're doing with the money, the look at some of the players nowadays, the beating of their wives, the a lot of things that they're doing now. They make a name for themselves by being able to play pro football, to you know, have people look up to them. Sure. Like I you know, it's, I'm sorry, man, I'm getting old or just forgetting a bunch of players' names.
But when they don't take, well, if you don't take advantage of the opportunities that are put in front of you, you can throw it all away. I mean, in a day, and you know, the league is making so much money. The player, I mean, the owners and the fields and the teams, they make a lot of money. So subsequently, I don't begrudge anybody who makes a little bit of money, you know, because the shelf life for football players is not long.
That is true, and as, you know, I would tell the players, get the greenbacks when you can, because you're like a piece of meat. I always told my, I tell my wife this. I said, you're like a piece of meat. You go to the grocery store and you ask the butcher, oh, that piece of meat looks good to me, and you put it on the grill or whatever, you cook it up, and it tastes good, but you don't eat all of it, and you put it in the refrigerator. And you take it out and you want to have a snack. Well, it doesn't taste that good to you anymore. And that's the way that, that football is. Sure. You look at it, football players, you only last so long, and you're right. You know, you get got to take advantage of what's there. You look at, what's the guy's name? He's on TV right now. Deion Sanders.
Sure.
You've got to maintain that. You have to look at what got you that name. What, you know, I don't know what to say about, but I look at some of the players today, and I just think that they're putting glory before where they need to go. You need to understand. Look at the player that played basketball that just was killed in a plane crash.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Kobe Bryant.
He did so much. Look at LeBron. LeBron don't know that he went to a high school that when I was growing up, if you walk on the side of the street of that school, they would chase you off the street. Matter of fact, I got chased home from St. Vincent's, where LeBron James went to high school.
Sure.
My mother had already deceased. I was going home, and I heard this car coming up behind me, and they were banging on the side of the car. There's some niggers, excuse my language. But anyway, I was close to the cemetery, and I swear to God, I jumped over into the cemetery to get away from them, realized where I was, and I didn't even touch the ground on the other side of the cemetery. I jumped back and I ran.
We've all got those stories, that's for sure. There's no question about it. Hey, now, as a matter of fact, this interview will play, you know, for different times, but we've got this week coming.
I have to be honest with you. I don't like the game today. I think that they put too much safety in the games. There's too much protection in the game. And John Elway would still be playing if he had the
rules from today.
The rules of today. You can't touch a quarterback. You swipe down close to his head. It's a 15-yard penalty. You hit him below the knee. It's a 15-yard penalty. It's roughing the quarterback. There's so many.
Well, it's given. On the other side of that, I play devil's advocate with you. On the other side of that, you got Tom Brady, who says he wants to play past 45 if possible, and now he's going to another team, and he just got Gronkowski back with him. That's going to be trouble down there.
Yeah, but you got to look at it. Look at the protection that Brady has had the past five or something years. Look at the protection that the quarterbacks get nowadays. Look at the wide receivers, the protection that they're getting nowadays. All you hear and see is that official throwing a flag, and who's the flag thrown against? More likely it's the defensive back for pass interference. Oh, my God. Some of the hits that Lionel Taylor used to take. I pick on Lionel because Lionel used to make some fantastic catches and he'd get his bell rung or whatnot. I have to tell you one story about myself before my end of career. Yep. I was with the Washington Redskins in 1967. And we were playing against the Philadelphia Eagles. And I had gone to bed that night. We stayed at the hotel. And my roommate's wife brought him a home-cooked meal and brought some candy over. And M&M's candy bar and a Snickers candy bar. She offered me something. And I took the candy bar and whatnot. But I'm a joker. I love to see people laugh and have fun. And so I get up the next morning. I go to pregame meal. I go to skull session. I drive my car to the stadium. I mess with the stadium guards in D.C. I go put on my uniform and go out and I kick off and do everything that I was supposed to do.
Sure.
And so we go out at the start of the game. We tossed the coin out on the center field. Philadelphia won, and they selected to receive. And I kicked off. And when I kicked off, Timmy Brown caught the ball, and he broke through our line of scrimmage. And Chris Hamburg was chasing him down, and I was the last of the fence. I hit Timmy from the front at the same time Chris Hamburg was hitting him from the back. And it felt like somebody had hit me with an axe down the center of my head. I stayed down for a second, but then I hopped right up and went to the sideline. I'll just say this to you. I played the whole game. Brig Owens came to me, asked me how he was a defensive back for the Redskins. Brig Owens asked me how to defend against the wide receiver coming off the ball. Charlie Taylor used to ask me how could he run a pass pattern. Sonny Jorgensen would come to me and ask me. They would go away. They would be laughing at everything I would tell them. But, they went out on the field and did it. And it worked.
From that incident, though, you wound up. They wouldn't even let you go home. They made you go to the hospital. Correct.
After the game was over, I'm in my little cubby hole, and Brig Owens sticks his head around the corner and say, "Hey, Mango," he said, "what you gonna do tonight?" I said, "Well, man, after I shower, I'm going outside and get my wife and son, and take them to dinner." He said, "You gonna do what?" I said, "You heard me. I'm gonna get my wife and son and take them to dinner." Next thing I heard was, "Hey, Doc." He said, "Yeah." He said, "You better come and take a look at Mingo." He said, "I asked him what he's gonna do after he showered. He said he's gonna go outside and get his wife and son and take them to dinner." And Doctor said, "Well, what's wrong with that?" He said, "Doc, his wife and son are in Denver, Colorado." And you can talk about
bell rung.
But I was out for I don't remember that. Anyway, I wake up 3 days later, a Wednesday afternoon. I wake up with these two nurses at the foot of my bed. If you've ever seen the movie or the show Flying Nuns, they had those winged hats on. And they they were coming, the sun was coming through the window, hitting those Venetian blinds. And those girls had a glow to them. I hadn't raised my head up off the pillow yet. And I heard the one girl say, let me go get the doctor. And so she went out the room, and as the doctor was coming in, I started to raise my head, and I felt that shock again, as if somebody had hit me in the middle of the head with an axe. And so I said, what time is it? I got to get to the stadium. He said, what? I said, you heard me. I said, I got to get to the stadium. I got a game to play. And he said, what day is this? I said, it's Sunday. I said, I got to get to the stadium. He said, just a minute, Gene. Take it easy, Gene. And he reached over on the lid. My roommate had been in to see me. And he hands me the paper. And on the sports page, it says, Mingo kicks tying field goal 35-35. And I tell you,
what day was this again? Wednesday. you missed Monday, Tuesday, and part of Sunday.
I missed all that, and man. I even today I still have problems with the side of my head. But they said that there's nothing wrong, and the doctor put me on a CPAP machine for sleep all this year.
So if you had it to do over again, would football still be a choice for you?
Well, actually, I would probably take football, but my uncle didn't speak for me for 2.5 years because I could throw from the catcher's position. I didn't have to stand up to throw to second base. All you used to hear was, he's gone, and I would throw. And all I asked was the pitcher to duck because I would throw directly at the pitcher's head, and that ball would hit second base at the waist or knee high. And that way he would slide right into the tag. And when I was in the Navy, I played catcher for the Norfolk Navy Tars. And the same thing, they would holler, he's gone. I wouldn't even come out of my position. So I could have played pro baseball. Jackie Robinson is his name. I'm not trying to take Jackie Robinson's name, but what I did during the 10.5 years I played pro ball, I did it because I loved the game. It wasn't for the money. When I started my career in pro football, I started out making $6,500. They don't even walk on the field for that much money nowadays. That was $6,500.
No.
But back in the 60s, that was a lot of money to people.
And so once you retired, you retired right here in Denver, is that correct?
I retired in Denver. I got tired of moving around. Like I told you, each team I played for after I left the Broncos was 1.5 years. And they tried their best to get me out of the game. And finally, I gave the Pittsburgh Steelers the opportunity. Chuck Noll, we played the Cincinnati Bengals, and it was windy as hell and raining like crazy. And Ray Mansfield wasn't snapping the ball. And the same thing, Chuck told me, I got to let you go. You kicked the rat again the game, Sonny. They tried everything to get me out of the game, and I did.
So if people like your story, hear your story, read up about Gene Mingo, and this Hall of Fame, they have a seniors kind of deal as well, don't they? In terms of they'll pick some guys that have been retired past their time.
Yeah. I've had several people tell me that you should be in the Hall of Fame and for what you did. You know, my son kept a scrapbook of what his dad did, Gino Mingo. And I saw a piece that he had in there that I had forgot about, to tell you the truth. It was when I was with the Oakland Raiders. And Al Davis was trying to get the teams to merge, you know, the NFL and the AFL to merge. And the NFL were stealing players from the AFL, and the AFL would steal. Well, he would talk to John Brody and trying to get John Brody to come over to the Oakland Raiders. And then the next thing I know, the San Francisco 49ers tried to get me to move over to them. And I should have, in a sense, I think I should have, because it would have been more limelight. Hey, a black field goal kicker. You haven't seen another black field goal kicker in the NFL.
Nope.
And I retired from the game in 1960. They told me, or last year, I think I heard of a white kicker. He was kicking his 41st or 42nd year.
Yep.
In the game.
Yep. And as a matter of fact, this past week, Tom Dempsey passed away at 83. Now, he was a square-toed kicker as well back in the day.
Well, let me tell you something. When I left the Pittsburgh Steelers, Jack Faulkner was with the New Orleans Saints, and I went to their training camp. They held their training camp in Oakland, in San Diego, and we went out to San Diego. I had beaten Tom Dempsey out for kicking.
Talk to me.
I had beat him out for kicking field goals.
Isn't that something?
And because of the public relations man, I almost had his name. Ernie Wheelwright.
All right, okay.
With walking past the coach's room, and he heard the public relations man say, "Oh, you don't have to worry about Gene." He says, "I got him," and I was cut that next. Within 2 hours, I was cut from participating with the New Orleans Saints, and Tom Dempsey was able to keep his job. See, I had to fight for every inch I did on the field. I guess that's why my wife, Sally, father told her that Gene was tough, and I told you, I was always taught there was no can't. You tried this as best you could.
That's it. That's what our parents told us back in the day. And I'm sure the parents of today are still the same way. Gene Mingo, number 21, Ring of Famer for the Denver Broncos. Hey, man, I appreciate your time, and I hope everybody listens to your story. I hope if they feel so inclined, maybe this is how we start that email chain, going to Canton, going to the Hall of Fame and saying, take a look at this guy's records. Take a look at this, what he did on the field. Take a look at the time when he played, and the fact that you're still kicking, still here and still kicking, and still got it. I've got a picture of those shoes, and we're gonna put those into the story. I just want you to know, hey man, our hearts are with you. You've done so much for the game, and people should appreciate it. And if you're a youngster watching this, this is the kind of guy you want to emulate. This is a man you want to emulate, because once you got out, not only did you get your GED, but you became a counselor at one of the drug prevention places here in Denver. Very good work. Very good work taking care of other people. Gene Mingo, thank you so much. Tell your lovely wife hello for us, and we'll see you down the road and somewhere on the sideline, my friend. That's going to do it for us, and I appreciate you being with us.
I appreciate you having me on. Thank you so much.
Not a worry. And that's going to do it for Gridiron Media this edition. We'll be back with more just around the corner. All right, that's going to do it for us, John Bowman. We'll see you next time.